Hello guys, welcome to my channel Chem Insider. So in today's class we are going to discuss about topic from your structure of atom chapter. So in today's class we are discussing a topic which is related to shape of atomic orbital. So the shape of the atomic orbital, clearly we know it is defined by the azimuthal quantum number, right? So the azimuthal quantum number has certain values, and each of the certain values of azimuthal quantum number gives a subshell. So for L is equal to 0, we have S subshell. For L is equal to 1, we have P subshell. For L is equal to 2, we have D subshell. And L is equal to 3, we have F subshell. Okay. So now we are going to understand the probability of finding an electron in the given certain S, P, D, F subshells. So now let us start with the probability of finding an electron in the S subshell. So if you consider S subshell, and especially in case of 1s orbital and 2s orbital. So if you consider subshells or orbitals of 1s and 2s, and we know probability of finding electron is denoted by the symbol psi, right? So this is the probability of finding an electron wave function, and psi square is the probability density, right? So probability density, psi is the wave function for atomic orbital. So if you consider atomic orbital or the probability of finding an electron in an atomic orbital function as psi square versus radius of the atom, if you consider or if you plot a graph of probability of an atom, wave function of an atomic orbital, or the probability of finding an electron in an atomic orbital versus r for 1s and 2s orbital, what you'll observe is for 1s orbital, if r is at the x-axis and psi is on y-axis, what happens is the atomic orbital's probability will be maximum at certain smaller radius. It will be maximum at a higher radius, and it decreases gradually, just like this. Okay, that is because if you consider a nucleus of an atom of 1s orbital, if you consider this as a nucleus, and it has electron at a particular position, what happens is the number of electrons in this 1s orbital will be maximum around this nucleus in this range, in this cloud. Okay, so therefore, since we have certain radius difference here, so at this particular point of r will have maximum probability of finding an electron. Similarly, for psi square, that will be almost similar to this. It will be like this. Okay, for 1s orbital, if you consider the same for 2s orbital, if you consider the same graph for 2s orbital, what we observe is slightly different when compared to 1s orbital. Yeah. That is, it increases at a point and then further decreases and slightly gives a maxima at a second position. So this is the first maxima and this will be the second maxima. In test books, you will observe the graph being plot at this position. Graph being plot from this position like this. Doesn't matter, you can start from here also, or you can take from here also. What in this type of reactions, what in this graph it happens is, you won't exactly have electron at the zero radius, right? If you start from this point, that means r is equal to zero. If r is equal to zero, that means your electron is inside the nucleus. It will never happen, okay? Remember that. There might be slight mistakes in those conditions. What happens is, electrons will be present slightly outside the nucleus. So therefore, you have to write certain value in order to show a peak of higher maximum probability. Okay. So therefore, we have a maximum probability at the initial value, and later it shows one more maximum at a different point of r for a 2s orbital. That is because a 2s orbital system has 1s and 2s both in it. It has both 1s and 2s. That is, if you consider the principal quantum numbers and azimuthal quantum number we have discussed in the earlier classes, if n is equal to 2, it can have value l is equal to 0 and 1, right? For l is equal to 0, we have ml is equal to 0, which this gives us S subshell, and this gives us P subshell, right? When you take n is equal to 2, it will must and should contain a value of n is equal to 1. It must contain n is equal to 1. So therefore, if you consider for a 2S system, it will have both 1S and 2S. So this peak will be similar to the 1S peak, but will have a second maxima at the 2S positions at a slightly different R. So this type of graph clearly indicates that the atom electrons present on the nucleus of 2s orbital, if you consider this as the nucleus, the electrons will be present in two different atmospheres. One is like this at this point, okay, and we have one more electron density at a slightly different radius. Let us say if this is the second radius, the atoms will be more at this position, so giving us 2s orbital with two different maximas, okay, with two different maximas. So this is how the graph of wave function or the probability of finding an electron versus R is plot, which gives us a complete idea of explaining the probability of finding an electron in a given atom. So if you observe here, we have a point where the nodal, the point where the probability of finding the electron reaches zero. Okay, so this point where the probability of finding an electron touches zero is called nodal point. This point is called nodal point, is also called as node. So a node is defined as the position at which probability of finding an electron is zero. That is, psi square will be zero at a node point. A nodal point is a position of R, point of R, at which probability of finding an electron will be zero. Okay, so now in order to understand the exact shape of an atomic orbit, subshells like azimuthal quantum numbers, wave functions, we need to consider boundary surface diagrams. So we need to consider a topic of boundary surface diagrams. This boundary surface diagrams are nothing but the diagram arised because of considering the probability of finding an electron in an atom. So what is this boundary surface diagram? So boundary surface diagrams are the one in which probability of finding an electron will be maximum at its boundaries. So that is, if you consider the 1s orbital, the electrons in this boundary surface diagram of 1s orbital will be in this manner. Electrons will be completely inside this sphere except at the center. So this is because the probability of finding an electron inside a 1s orbital of a boundary surface diagram is 90% accurate, because we know that we cannot determine exact position and exact momentum of electron. So therefore, the probability of finding an electron inside an atomic orbital of 1s is about, for example, extent of 90%. So this is the point where we won't have any number of electrons to be found. That means the electrons will be positioned in the boundaries of the 1s orbital. Similarly, if you consider 2s orbital, it will be of a slightly bigger shape because of its increasing size. As we know, azimuthal quantum number increases, size of the atomic orbital also increases, right? So this again has extent of 90% of probability of finding an electron. So therefore, if you consider 1s orbital or 2s orbital, we can clearly say that s orbital will be of the shape, sphere. S orbital will be of spherical shape in 3 dimension. If you observe this in 2 dimension, it will be in a circular shape. That is nothing but, if you start and go extend for a distance of finding an electron, the probability of finding an electron from the nucleus towards a certain distance will be equal in all direction. So if you take distance at this position, the probability of finding electron will be same. If you take in this direction, it will be same. So therefore, in a S subshell orbital, probability of finding an electron from the nucleus will always be similar. It won't change at all. So therefore, S orbitals are called symmetric orbitals. So shape of S orbital will always be spherical, and those are always symmetric in nature. That is, probability of finding an electron will be same in all directions. Okay, so this is about surface diagram of s orbital. Now for the surface diagram of p orbital, so before that, we said we have certain nodes, right? For s orbital, the number of nodes depends upon the principal quantum number. The number of nodes present in an s orbital depends upon the principal quantum number. That is, for every n value, we have n minus 1 nodes. For every principal quantum number of n, then s orbital will have n minus 1 nodes. For every principal quantum number of n, s orbital will have n minus 1 nodes. That is what we observed in the probability of 1s orbital. We didn't have any nodes because it was n is equal to 1, 1 minus 1 will be 0. In case of second 2s orbital, we observed 1 node because 2s orbital n is equal to 2, 2 minus 1 gives 1, therefore it has 1 node. So these nodes in the s orbital are called radial nodes. These nodes are called radial nodes because they are defined on the basis of x-axis taken as radius of the atom. So therefore those nodes are called radial nodes. S orbital will, for every n value of an s orbital, it will have n minus 1 nodes. Now next we'll go to p orbital, shape of p orbital. So the shape of p orbital is defined with respect to comparing them with the coordinate axis x, y, z. So if you consider the x, y, z axis, if you consider x, y, z axis such as like this, x, z and y axis. So your y axis is towards u. So if you consider x, y, z axis of the coordinate system, then you will have minus z, minus y and minus x also, right? So this will be the three-dimensional space arrangement of the coordinate axis of x, y, z. For the boundary surface diagram of p orbital, let us consider p. So p orbital comes into existence only when n is 2. When n is equal to 2, we will have l as 0 and l is equal to 1. So if n is equal to 1, we will have just l is equal to 0. Therefore, if n is equal to 1, we have only one subshell, that is s. If you have n is equal to 2, we have two subshells, then only we can come across the p shell. So for a p subshell to come into play, we need to take at least of n is equal to 2. Okay, so let us start with the 2p orbital itself. If you consider 2p orbital, the 2p orbital's boundary line diagram shows three types of lobes. The 2p orbital will not have a spherical shape. The 2p orbital will not have a spherical shape. It will be in the form of like this. So if this is the x axis and this is the y axis and this is z axis, it will have lobes in this manner. So this is, so that is, if you consider these as the two lobes which I have written here, the probability of finding the electron will be maximum in x axis. Then this is called px orbital. So that is, if you consider this as the orbital and x axis is passing through these two lobes, so the probability of finding the electron will be zero at the center, that is zero at the nucleus. So probability of finding an electron will be zero at the nucleus. Y axis is in this direction towards you, x axis toward away from me, z axis in this direction. So therefore we have a plane zx, the plane z and y cuts through these two lobes, the plane zy, yz plane cuts through these two lobes, and the probability of the electron being found in this plane of yz is zero. That is, if you cut this in this manner, the probability of finding the electron in this plane, that is nothing but it has x and z axis and passing through the center of the nucleus, then it will be zero. And further, what we observe over here is the orbital will be asymmetric. The orbital will be asymmetric. So if you have plus in this direction, then we have minus in the opposite direction. Okay, so this is about the p orbit. This is about the px orbital. Okay, so these lobes of boundary surface diagram, if you consider this as the electrons, so what happens is, if I write it in a bigger size, so these are the lobes. So the finding the electron will be placed at the nucleus. Okay, there is no electrons here. So the electrons will be bound at the opposite lines. So the orientation will be maximum along x-axis, but zero at the center of the nucleus, that is zero at the center. Therefore, this is what the p orbital orientation looks like. So if this is along the x-axis, then that lobe is called px orbital. If it is along y-axis, that is like this, then it is called py, which is written as, if you consider this as x, then the p orbital will be like this. Okay, so that is directed towards u. If you consider for the z-axis, so this is py. If you consider for z-axis, that is in the form of this. Okay, like this. So this is, see, so this will be the z-axis, which is oriented in the x-axis, pz orbital. If it is oriented in the x-axis, then it is called px orbital. If it is oriented towards u in the y-axis, then it is called py orbital. So for e subshell, we have three orbitals. Those are px, py and pz. Remember, this px, py, pz has nothing to do with the ml values of minus 1, 0 and plus 1. We usually relate them with 0, minus 1, 0, plus 1, because for every L value we have ml is equal to minus 1, 0, plus 1. This relation has not been proved, but we consider this relation for our own purpose in order to understand certain stuffs. So therefore, the values of minus 1, 0, plus 1 can alter between these three. They can always alter between these three. We can take py as minus 1, pz as 0, px as plus 1. Or you can also take py as plus 1, pz as 0, py as minus 1. It does not change any structure of an atom. It is not at all related to one another. So this is about the shape of px, py, pz orbital, in general p orbitals. So p orbital, p subshell is having three orbitals. Those orbitals are px, py and pz. Each of them are oriented in the x-axis, y-axis and z-axis. Okay, so this is about the shape or boundary surface diagram of p orbital. Next, for boundary surface diagram of d orbital. Now for the boundary surface diagram of d orbital, we have L is equal to 2, right? For L is equal to 2, we have ML equal to minus 2, minus 1, 0, plus 1, plus 2. So clearly we'll have 5D orbitals. We'll have 5D orbitals. Those D orbitals are DXY, DYZ, DXZ, DX square minus Y square, and then DZ square. So if you observe over here, these three are one type, these two are the other type. We'll study those in later in the higher classes. But for now, just remind these five different orbitals of D. Even though these are named in a different manner, all these five orbitals of D will be degenerating energy. That means all of them will have same energies. All these five D orbitals will have same energy. And for the orientation of this, it is written as, if you take this as z-axis, if you consider this as z-axis, this as x and this as y. If you consider this as x, y and z-axis, dxy is the lobes which have two lobes. Dxy has two lobes. So therefore, let us consider these five lobes, dxy, if you consider xyz as the three coordinate systems, so dxy will be in the direction lying on the plane of xy. So if you, let us say, if this is the x-axis, if this is x-axis and this is y-axis, the orbitals will be oriented between the x and y-axis. So therefore, so if you observe here, this is the x-axis and this is our y-axis. The lobes of d orbital will be lying between x and y axis and on the plane of xy. So if this is x and y axis, this will be the xy plane. Okay, this will be the xy plane. So the lobes will be lying in between of xy axis. So if you observe over here, what happens is the lobes will be in the direction of this way. X, Y, X, Y, X. Okay. And there will be one more set of lobes between these two. Okay. Even though I have written this in the two plane, it will be like this. Okay. In the X shape. If you consider this, so it will be like this in manner. X axis being in this direction, Y axis in this direction. So this plane which contain both X and Y axis is called XY plane. So the lobes will be present on the XY plane. So therefore, d orbitals have three orbitals. D orbital, d subshell has three orbital where d orbital has five subshells, out of which three subshells will be in lying in the plane. This one will also lie in a plane. Four orbitals will lie in a plane where out of those four, three will be in between two axes. Three orbitals will be lying on the two axes, lying between two axes. If you consider X and Y, if the lobes are lying in between X and Y axis, so this is X axis, this is Y axis. So this lobe is completely in between X and Y axis and present on the plane of XY. Similarly, if you take YZ, so if you take this as Z axis, this as X axis, and you have Y axis in this direction, so I'll write this like this, then the lobes will be between X and Y. Okay, so if you consider this as Y axis, if you consider this as Z X, this is Y, and if Z is in this direction, the lobes will be in the direction of X and Z like this. It will be present in the this manner. Okay, so that is the orbitals will be above and below of the z-axis, and the one more lobe will be in this manner. Okay, so how can I write this in better way is, I'll erase this one. So let us take the non-lying orbit towards u. If I take x-axis towards u, and we have y here and the z here, then the orbitals will be x-axis in towards yours, x-axis in this direction. So therefore, the orbitals will be lying in between yz axis. Okay, so this is dyz, where x-axis towards you, x-axis is lying towards you in the 3 dimension. And for the dxz, if you consider this x-axis, this as z-axis, then the lobes will be between the two xz plane, between the two x and z axis, and plane will be the board, plane of board. Okay. Remember, we have changing the coordinates over here. Remember that point. You just don't want to write xz, xz, xz everywhere. So these are the three different shapes of dxy, dyz and dzx. For dx square and y square, what happens is the lobes, these four lobes will lie on x and y axis. For dx square minus y square, we have lobes lying on, so if this is x and this is y and you are taking z towards u, then lobes will be lying exactly on x and y axis. Okay, so the lobes will be lying on exactly on x and y axis. So therefore, this lobe is called dx square, 2dx square minus y square lobe. So clearly, this lobe is again falling in the plane of xy plane. Okay, and lastly, for the dz square orbital, if you consider this as x axis and this as z axis, the lobe will be in this direction with z square, and we have a one spherical node present over here like a circular disk for a d orbital. So d orbital have 5, d subshell has 5 orbitals, those are dxy, dyz, dzx, in which the lobes, 4 lobes will be lying in between the axis which is given. It will be lying in the x and y axis, in between x and y axis, or it might be lying on the xy plane. Similarly, yz, it will be lying between x and yz, it will be lying between y and z axis, and will be on the zy plane. In case of xz, xz, it will be lying on between of x and z axis on the plane of xz. And for the dx square minus y square, the four lobes will be mutually lying on the x square and y square, x square and y square axis, and for dz square we have an orbital lying on z axis with a circular disk at the center. Okay, so these are the five boundary surface diagrams of d orbital. If you observe in these cases, you again have a nodes and consider to p and d orbital. When you compare p and d orbitals along with s orbital, we'll have nodes present in p and d orbitals also. So apart from the radial nodes which we have observed in the s orbital had radial nodes, right? S orbital had radial nodes, but p and d orbital have radial node along with one more type of node called angular node, which is called angular nodes. So this angular nodes is because it have a zero at the center. Okay, so the p and d orbital have the zero of probability of finding an electron density zero at the nucleus. So therefore p and d orbital have one more extra node when compared to s orbital. S orbital has only one node, which is given calculated by the formula n minus 1, whereas the total number of nodes for p and d orbital is given by the formula n minus l minus 1. The total number of nodes of p and d orbital is given by the formula n minus l minus 1, where n is the principal quantum number and l is the azimuthal quantum number. For p, in order to find the number of nodes for p orbital, l will be equal to 1. For p, l will be equal to 1, and for d, l will be equal to 2. And for f, similarly, l will be equal to 3. Okay, so therefore, the total number of nodes for p orbital will be n minus 2. The total number of nodes for p orbital will be n minus 2. For l orbital will be n minus 3, and for f orbital it will be n minus 4. So these are about the nodes which are present in p and d orbital. So p and d orbital have two types of nodes. One is a radial node and the other one is angular node, which is denoted by its respective l value. Okay, so this is all about the shape of orbitals. So in the next class we'll discuss about energy of each of these orbitals, and later we'll discuss about the different different laws which we have to follow in order to fill the electronic configuration of given atomic orbitals. I hope you have understood all these three of shapes of s, p and d. You don't have the shape of f in your syllabus. We'll discuss this in the higher classes. So if you have understood completely, please do subscribe to my channel and share this video among your friends who have difficulty in understanding this particular concept, and ask them to subscribe to my channel also in order to get more updates on new videos. Thank you for watching.